One of the reasons man chose to leave God's side in the Garden of Eden was because he felt fear, and fear continues to govern our lives. Because we make decisions out of fear, we are influenced by fear, and we often assume a personality because of our fears. Good morning, I am Pastor Carlos Rios, and this is our devotional Mana, a daily adventure with God. Greetings to the men that are tuning in to this devotional. There have been many new men who are now joining us. And I want to make an announcement to all the men. Remember that we have our YouTube channel, Devotional Mana, where you can write to us through the chat and you can let us know what your opinions are on this topic and any questions that you may have. What other topics would you like to listen to? Write to us, let us know, because we are completely interested and we want to ensure that this devotional is edifying day after day for our lives. In fact, this is why we are organizing an event in the United States, September 16th in Orlando, Florida, September 23rd in Long Island, New York. Here we will be meeting for an entire day with expert conferencists and through workshops, lessons that I know will leave great lessons for our lives. This is a great gift, so invite a brother, a husband, a friend, a co-worker, your son. And this is what we are organizing. We want you to come with someone and we will provide refreshments, food, materials. Everything will be covered. And so if you have not yet registered, please do so by going to our webpage, Devotional Mana, where you can register, make payment, and secure a spot. Okay, let's talk about the fears that govern us. When Adam and Eve fell, the Bible says that they hid from God. And of course, we ask ourselves why. But we know that, for example, when we commit mistakes and when we have been warned of possibly making this mistake, then of course, typically our first reaction is this: to hide, to deny, to justify, to point fingers. And this is what happened in the Garden of Eden. But this left a line of conduct for humanity. Men, ask yourselves, how many of us are governed by fears? Let's analyze the first point, the fear to be rejected. In numerous situations, occasions, we often suppose that we will be rejected, and frequently this deprives us from enjoying valuable relationships. Men, allow me to tell you, sometimes we isolate ourselves. Sometimes I feel that men are retracted. We stand aside, separated from the group. And that is not good. You should not live without close relationships, because some fear of human relationships is normal. It is normal to feel some amount of anxiety when we are with others who are like us. And I know that it is not easy to live amongst other people and have good relationships with them, because when we have many relationships, it means that we must learn to receive, to accept criticism. But sometimes we feel that what's easiest is to become isolated and condemn others, blame others. And when we feel rejected or challenged by others, then we experience a desire to control others or to understand what they are thinking. And sometimes this leads to us seeking ways to impress others in order to seek acceptance, to receive acceptance. In addition to the fear of rejection is the fear of failure. I believe this feeling is very common in the hearts of men, because often we fear not being capable, not being able to fulfill our obligations, not meeting the expectations of our wife, our children, our boss, our friends. And I believe this is really a heavy load that we carry. And this is why I'm saying that often men, we do not, or we prefer not to have close friends, because we often feel fear of failing them, and we do not want to experience a failed friendship. And this is a common byproduct of an isolated person, a person who is alone, and it is not good for us to be alone. In spiritual terms, I've mentioned previously, I've given an example of, for example, animals when they go out to hunt, or when predators hunt, what they attempt to do is to isolate their prey. And when the prey is isolated alone, it is the best time. It is the moment to catch them. We should not be alone, because if we are alone, we are carrying the complete weight by ourselves. We have no one to correct us, to help us, to give us good advice. We need good friends, close friends, with whom we can have a very close relationship, an intimate relationship that is honest, where we can tell one another the truth without hurting each other, but with the purpose of correcting, helping. And I believe that these are the true friends that we need. Because often we have many friends, but truly they are more superficial, just perhaps during festivities, certain occasions, but not intimate friends who truly help us. Another conflict that we sometimes carry as men is guilt. I want to make something clear. Do you know why we often feel guilty? It is because we are guilty. And because we do not know how to manage guilt, this becomes a weight on us, carrying our past on our shoulders. There are many men who made mistakes with previous marriages and ended up with failed marriages, with broken relationships, perhaps failures as parents, because they did not know how to manage a certain situation. So we live with a bunch of guilt, maybe even financially, if we have not been able to meet our obligations. And this continues to eat at us. And this is why often we end up intertwined in alcohol, drugs, or others sometimes seeking solutions, get into another relationship, then another relationship. And this further complicates things, complicates our lives, not knowing how to deal with guilt. When there is something that we must always keep in mind in regards to our Lord Jesus, and this is that He came to forgive our sins, and that when we truly learn to understand, to accept that we made a mistake, as we mentioned in last week's devotional, we must learn to ask for forgiveness. If I feel that I am a victim because of my parents, because of what they did with me, because of situations that occurred, then I must forgive instead of assuming a position of victim, where typically I repeat the same story. No, instead we must ask for forgiveness. We must acknowledge that we made a mistake, but we cannot continue making the same mistake all the time. Another load that we carry as men often is becoming isolated. That often is joined with what we just discussed, fear of failure, guilt, because these things lead us men to become isolated. If we do not have anyone to discuss our fears with, then what we often do, is create a type of mask. And the purpose of this mask is that others do not approach us. For this reason, many men are seen as being antisocial, or they do not want to join or have meetings or gather with other people or to be in groups. But the reason for this is not that this person doesn't want to be with others. Perhaps not having the courage to face reality, the courage to know that being alone is not good. In fact, I believe that one of the most important things in the life, in our lives as human beings, are our interpersonal relationships. When God said it is not good for man to be alone, He was not just talking about marriage. Interpersonal relationships are vital for us because God created us as social beings. And how great it is to be able to count on good friends, on true friends. How wonderful it is for us to be in healthy environments with friends where we correct one another, where we call each other's attention, where we speak truth to one another in love and sincerity without harmful intentions or to criticize, but instead because we are truly, honestly interested in the well-being of the other person. I have to acknowledge something as a pastor in Latin America, and it is that unfortunately in our Latin culture, although we are folkloric and happy and spontaneous, in the same way there are other things that are not positive and characterize our culture. For example, hypocrisy in relationships, falsehood, lies. Often we do whatever it takes to show something that we are not, to keep up with appearances. And I believe that this is fatal in relationships. But yes, although there are these types of people, I want to tell you, all of you who are isolated, there are also good people. There are people who want to help. There are people who want to be true friends. And so, in this order of ideas, my dear men, do not close up. Do not become isolated. Do not become filled with guilt or with fear. Do not allow the fear of rejection or of failure end up paralyzing your life, because the Bible is very clear in telling us that the Lord came to bring us freedom. And this is the freedom that the Lord came to give all of us. And this is why I insist that we must allow God to work in our lives, on our lives, because when the Holy Spirit works on us, the Bible says that who is in Christ is a new creation, because the Lord changes our heart of stone into a heart of flesh, because the Lord is able to change, to restore, and to renew a wounded heart or a heart that has made mistakes. When we arrive to the feet of the Lord, our Lord promises a new life. He promises to transform our life. This is why we do not offer religion. We are offering Christianity as a way of life that has an impact on your entire life. Another load with which men live with can be justification. And do you know what the issue is with justifying? The problem is that we continuously do not admit our mistakes. We do not admit our fears, our insecurities, and our sins. And as a consequence, when we live this way, we are deceiving ourselves. We are lying to ourselves. For example, I'll give you a simple example. If you go with your partner to a meeting with your spouse, and let's say you made a wrong turn and you got lost and you arrived late. And when we arrive, somebody asks, "Were you lost?" And the man answers, no, truly we were not lost. We just had to make a few different turns. But we are here, we arrived. Almost as if we are not capable of admitting that we were lost and simply say, "Yes, we were lost." It's incredible, because we have become accustomed to this. We have become accustomed to lying. And this leads me to a critical point in regards to us men. And I know that many will identify with this, because many women ask, "I'll take it a step further. Even my wife has criticized this of me, and I have had to go through a process of healing in regards to this in my life." And this is our silence, because many men, the majority of men, whether we are believers or not, we often tend to live in silence. And people may find this strange, because they may think I am a great speaker, or I am good at holding a conversation. My task is to speak, and I speak day, night, wherever I go, I have to speak. But at a personal level, I must acknowledge that one of the greatest issues, problems I had with my wife when we began our relationship was this. I did not speak much at home, so my wife would say, "What should I do? How do I know what you are thinking? How do I know what are we going to do?" Because often when the woman wants to share her emotional condition, the husband experiences a sense of anxiety. And this is why, in many occasions, men prefer to even work long hours at the office instead of arriving at home. Tremendous. Now, look, an expert once said, because men do not understand nor know how to express their emotions, they do not know how to deal with emotional pain. And so when men feel pain because of this, they do not understand it, and they do not know what to do with it. So sometimes the only idea that comes to their mind is to become numb. Because if we become numb, if we do not see it, feel the pain, the fear, and we feel that eventually everything will pass. But that's not the case. Because this numbness, this anesthesia lasts for just a while. But as time passes, things become graver, because they lead to destructive habits. I'm going to tell you, or speak to you, of something I hear very commonly when we speak to families, to wives. They often say, "My husband is a hero at work. He is admired, respected, And of course, because the husband knows that in this environment, he is the expert, the person who knows it all, who can do it all, who can resolve any matter. And everybody seeks him and needs him. In this environment, he is a hero. But when he gets home, at home, they know him exactly as he is. He is no longer the expert, the engineer. Now he is the husband that is never home, that doesn't fix anything, that doesn't pay the bills on time, where the children are being rebellious and he never speaks with them, where he never goes to church. And so do you see this scene? And so we ask, why, the women ask, why is my husband what he is in the office, at the office, where he was nice and kind and friendly with everyone? He brings them things, brings everyone treats. And here at home, he is stubborn, always in a bad mood. And this is a very interesting topic, isn't it? And so, of course, when exposed to these things, it's easy to say, well, I'd rather just stay in the office longer than to be in a place where I'm criticized. I'm not saying that this is good or bad. What I am saying is that it is a reality so that we can understand that perhaps we are the most valuable experts at work because we are great at what we do. But at home, where we are not fulfilling our duties, we are failing. And that sometimes, by dear men, it is easier to handle the external matters compared to our personal matters or our own homes. And so there are a great number of men who do great at work, although commonly it is not the same at home. And that often us as men, through our silence, we pretend that things are fine. Well, inside of us, there are many questions, unanswered questions. While women share their internal emotions with their friends, but the man continues as a hermit instead of talking about his life, his failures, his concerns. And this leads to insecurity. And insecurity leads to distrust in life. An insecure man is demanding by nature. And what we see is men who prefer to be served instead of serving, wanting to feel important, wanting to be the center of attention. This is why when we look at their favorite hobbies, they do not include their family. Because a man who is insecure becomes selfish. Common language for a man who is insecure is, everything goes wrong. Everyone speaks badly about me. Everyone has had it easy, but I've had to work. I have to handle my own happiness. No one understands me. No one visits me. No one cares about me. And the same insecurity leads men to be controlling, incredible, my dear family. And so we either seek the Lord or I do not know what we're going to do. Because truly, one thing leads to another. And I believe this topic merits a great deal of attention and to be very attentive. Men, do not be afraid with all these topics that we are discussing. But it is the truth. It is our own reality. I myself have gone through a bunch of situations and things I've had to overcome in my life. But allow me to tell you, the path in the Lord, knowledge of Scripture, these allow us to become better people each day. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for each man who has the courage in their heart to understand, to know that we cannot allow ourselves to be governed by these fears, because the Bible says that there is no fear in love, because God's perfect love casts out fear, and that in God we become completely new people. Bless each man, each family, and thank you for this time. In the name of Christ Jesus, amen and amen. May I wait for you tomorrow so that we may continue with this very interesting series. Blessings to all.